Good afternoon, everyone. This is Mohit from Moneyfront. As you all know, Moneyfront is one of the largest online platforms for direct plans of mutual funds. You all have been our esteemed clients, and there are many who don't still try and invest with us, but do check out our platform. It's one of the finest platforms you'll find today to offer direct plans amongst 26 fund houses of this country. And as we often do, we kind of invite few esteemed names and personalities in the from the financial market to have a live chat, live conversation around what is happening in the markets. And I'm sure we have a lot on our plate today. So without PMS division, which manages discretionary accounts and provides advisory services to institutional clients. He was transferred to the institutional equities team of DSP BlackRock Investment Managers in June of 2009. Rohit today manages DSP Equity Opportunities Fund, DSP Tech Saver Fund, DSP India T.I.G.E.R. Fund, DSP Natural Resources and New Energy Fund. So welcome, Rohit.
Thank you, Mohit.
To this live session. We have live audience who will keep joining us during the course of this session. But these are interesting times, and we're thankful to you for this session. There are our clients who are quite worried. There are clients who are worried on the equity front. There are clients who are worried on the debt front today. There's a lot of choppiness in the market. Off late for last two odd weeks, or I would say this month, we have seen extreme amount of volatility. Now, there's this one question which all of our clients want to ask you. What do you think about this recent correction which has happened in the market? Is this a deep one? Do we expect more, or do we expect markets to go further south? Or you think it's these, is that one of those phases in the market which keeps happening?
I think, Mohit, you know, if you're looking at the recent correction, I think it's very important to step back a little. You know, if you go back last 6-9 months in terms of what really happened in the market post the 2017 huge returns, right? The expectation was earnings growth will pick up, the macros will improve. So if anybody spoke about macros in the month of November, December or January this year, I think everyone was very positive on macros, whether it was inflation, current account deficit, fiscal deficit, right? What's happened over the last few months is, you know, one, because of all the news flows coming out of the US and the potential what US announces today, how does China react or act, that has led to some kind of uncertainty into global markets. Yes, we have seen some kind of a correction, and there are various and fair reasons to it, but whether it will continue for a longer period of time or how long, I think it's difficult to take one's guess. Our job is to sit on our desk, meet companies and try to validate investment arguments, what we have for our own stocks.
So basically you're saying currently the market psyche is getting impacted by two things. One is obviously there is global news flow, which is for real, which is, let's say, perhaps a trade risk kind of a scenario, or the currency or the oil scenario. And second is, I think people are getting impacted a lot by news and views around, which are floating around. and deviating a little from the fundamental attribute, which is you invest for a fairly long term and you invest with the fundamentals and you don't go wrong. Is that the correct way of looking at it?
Yeah, so Mohit, really what happens is, you know, today when we meet a corporate or a company, you know, before investing, what do we look at it, right? One is, we're meeting him, we're trying to gauge over the next 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, how the company's business will pan out, what kind of market share they have today, how will the market share grow, how will the profitability grow, ROEs improve, right? That's the bread and butter of the starting point. And then you feel, okay, if there is, say, you know, for example, I'll talk to you, you know, a lot of things were happening 3 years back on the UK front. They're moving out of the European Union, right? So if a company, you know, it's, you know, very much impacted by that kind of a business, they have a significant chunk of their business in those geographies, then you know, okay, fundamentally they're looking good. But there are macro factors which you may say, okay, I would not want to buy more of it, or I'll buy less of it today and buy more later on. When there are a lot of news flows around, do I have an answer for you today? If you would ask me what is going to be the next action from Trump, or what is China going to do next, do I know that? It's an if, right? We can talk about ours for it. So if there is an if, how do you turn your portfolio and say, okay, this is going to happen, so I'm going to turn my portfolio that way. The idea is for equity investors, and even for us more so importantly, if you have identified a stock, you're very sure about the fundamentals, the key parameters why you bought the stock. I think the idea is to take the pain in the near term, because when things subside, it may subside in the next 15 days, 1 month, 3 months, you don't know that. But in the end, if you're going to buy a stock whose fundamentals are right, they're going to give you returns. It's not going to be you have anything in a portfolio is going to go up. So at this time, as an investor also, if you're invested in any schemes, any funds, look at the portfolio. Okay, what kind of stocks the portfolio has? What's been the history of that portfolio manager or the scheme, right? In terms of how they manage and invest. that has maintained the core philosophy, and I don't think there's something to be worried about.
Absolutely. And the good part is we know all your funds have been like historically very well managed, and they all share a very good track record and long lasting track record. However, so Rohit, I buy your point that if you fundamentally do your research well and you buy the right companies with right profile and everything, you can go through these interim phases, but in the long term, obviously, you end up as winners. However, there is this lurking fear now which is coming out in the market that whatever is happening currently right now with certain kind of news flows around, can this be more deeper? Can we see deeper cuts in the market by virtue of any
I get what your point is saying. You know, thing is, news flows, no one can predict news flows.
Mm-hmm.
But as we see today, in terms of you mentioned about liquidity in the beginning,
right?
So again, for me, it is more important to identify stocks,
mm-hmm,
and see if I own some stocks, are there any liquidity fears? Are there, asset liability mismatches?
Right.
If they're not there, then I'm fine holding it for a longer period of time.
Okay.
I know they would correct, mm-hmm, they would not be left around. If the whole pack is falling, they would fall. But how do you know what is the right time to enter or what is the right price to exit to it? So in the end, you have to take some call. Okay, I like this stock. I've done all my checks. I've done my due diligence again. Yes, if the market, this is the way market reacts, I mean, the stock is going to react. But that is true for all the stocks in a portfolio, right?
Mm-hmm.
So again, it's individual stock call. It's more important. You have to take at this point of time and say, okay, I'm willing to stay with the pain.
Okay.
There are some stocks I think, the pain could be higher. And whether the stock is down 20% or 30%, it's never a, right or wrong time to sell or buy it.
Perfect. So Rohit, I let me call you on this one, basically, now that you're mentioning this point. Is there any particular space in the market which you are currently wanting to avoid, or you think that that's not a space to be touched in the current scenario and we should just avoidable for the time?
So again, as I said, I'm trying to give you slightly a vague answer, but the answer is, see, you have sectors, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sectors, there are some winners, some losers.
Right.
So just because there could be two or three losers,
mm-hmm,
you're not going to avoid the whole sector or say.
Okay.
It's, for us, it's pure bottoms up,
Right.
You like a particular stock, you own it.
Mm-hmm.
You may have a different view on a particular sector.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But then again, that's how money is made, right? If today you talk about, let me give you an example, like autos.
Mm-hmm.
Today autos, you have CVs, you have LCVs, you have four-wheelers, you have motor cars, you have auto ancillary.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at last 3, 4, 5 years of performance of stocks or the profitability, each and every them have performed variedly.
Right.
They haven't performed together.
Mm-hmm.
Today, if I say I'm positive on auto, what does it mean? Am I positive on two-wheelers, four-wheelers, that? So I think any sector you take a call, there will be negatives. You may have some pains in particular sectors. So I would say focus on stocks rather than on stocks.
Okay, so yeah, broadly we get your view, and once again let me get our audience back on this entire conversation out here. Welcome everyone to Moneyfront. We are live with Mr. Rohit Singhania from DSP, and we are discussing about the recent correction in market, right? And I think Rohit's view is that if your approach or philosophy of stock picking is right, then there are little chances that in the long term you will go wrong. There can be interim phases of correction, which is what market perhaps is going through.
And here I would like to add more with one thing. Like I said, when we buy companies, right?
Mm-hmm.
Today, if I buy a company and suddenly there's a shutdown in its plant or a lockout for 1 month, 2 months.
Right.
The company is going to face pains in this quarter or next quarter.
Perfect.
But is that the reason for me to, reverse my trade?
Mm-hmm.
Because when I bought the company, yes, there may be a delay. I thought, new capacity would come in after 12 months.
Right.
Now it will come in after maybe 15 months.
Mm-hmm.
But is that the only reason for which I need to reverse my trade?
Got it.
So that call, we have to keep on taking every day, because news flows will continue every day, every hour in this kind of a market.
Mm-hmm.
People who were talking something on extremes 3 months back, today they're going to talk on other extremes today. So I think that's the view as an investor also, and as a money manager also, we need to keep in mind and keep on questioning ourselves. Why did I own it 3 months back?
Perfect.
If I want to own it for the next 12 months, is it fair enough for me to own it or no?
As of now, still, do you think there is anything which is untouchable in the market? On a broad basis,
You must have heard me earlier. My philosophy is, at a price, everything is good.
Mm-hmm.
So never say nothing untouchable. because you may fall flat on your face. So I think at a price, everything is good. At a price, the best also you need to sell it out and book some profits out.
Perfect. Price is the only truth in the market, which is what
that's a fact,
right? Okay, so we'll move forward. Let's come to the broader economy, right? So currency has been depreciating. Now that's a fact which I think all of us are challenged to, with oil prices soaring globally, right? Do you see we face a macro challenge? And obviously interest rates, yesterday night Fed has raised rates, and likelihood of interest rates going up in the country is also very, very high, right? So how do you see the macro picture is shaping?
So I think let us divide this into three buckets: current account deficit, fiscal account deficit, and interest rates. So when you're looking at the fiscal account deficit, right, we traditionally as Indians were used to the subsidy in petrol and diesel.
Right.
So historically, 5 years back, you know, when oil used to shoot up, we used to be worried about fiscal deficit because government would need to give more subsidies and the fiscal deficit would go up.
Right.
Today, as you and me stand, we, and you know, for the audience, whichever cities you may be staying at, you know what prices you're paying for petrol and diesel per litre. So government is really not bearing your transportation subsidy per se. Yes, they're bearing the kerosene and LPG, but that's a small part of it. So just because of the oil going up, the fear of the fiscal deficit shooting up should not be there, one.
Okay.
Two, again, it's my personal view, you know, when you look at what happens, what is the meaning of fiscal deficit? You're spending more than your revenue, right?
Mm-hmm.
Today, it's been, this year is the election year. We have had one election 3 months back, one election December last year. And in looking at the governments, you know, in terms of whatever programs they have come out with or whatever announcements they have made, I don't think they are in a mood to spend out free money. So again, when you're not spending free, which is unproductive, then I think the fear on fiscal deficits is not so much right now. Coming to current account, yes, you know, if you see the last 2 months or so, if I get my numbers right, I think we have been current account deficit of $15 billion or more.
Right.
And that again has coincided with, if you see last 2 months, how the currency has moved.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the worry, right? Because today in India, you know, when you talk about the whole demography and the population and the nuclear family, we all want to consume a lot of things.
Absolutely.
Whatever, at whatever cost.
Right.
And most of it, maybe it's not manufactured into the country.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's what impacts your current account deficit and therefore your currency.
Okay.
So I think what move partly the government has taken yesterday in terms of, you know, increasing the import duties and few of the items, I think that should help.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the one number, but is the current account deficit I would be watching more so than the fiscal account deficit.
Okay.
On the inflation front, I think RBI has got its own, you know, CPI levels. I think, and we are there, we are about. So I don't think that's a worry. So if you would think, if you ask me about these three, what I would be worried about right now is the current account deficit.
Okay.
But yeah, I think government has understood that. We have seen some things happen yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Probably you could see more such actions coming.
Okay. So, but all in all, if you were to sum up the macro thing,
I would say if you take out the current deficit, because the fiscal, I'm not worried about the fiscal expansion by 20-30 basis points in what the government said in the budget.
Right.
We are a much better economy. We are getting more tax collections.
Mm-hmm.
GST is going to be a good thing for the country.
Right.
So yes, maybe, you know, it's like you're telling me I bought a company and saying it's going to do 100 rupees of EPS.
Mm-hmm.
Now it ends up doing 98. Is it that bad? Or is it fine with me, right? So if we get the current account,
definitely.
But mind you, we're not bad also.
Okay, that's an interesting point given the way oil and currency are poised basically, and that's I think one of the major factors which is looming around in terms of the fear psychosis which is playing out in the market currently, right? Just to continue on this entire thing, are you worried that bank loan growth basically, which is happening, and maybe because of all this, I would say the credit scenario which is emerging, the loan growth from banks might perhaps slow down, or the NBFC loan growth might slow down overall in the economy, or just the earnings part of the economy. Do you think it will play out as rosy as what people anticipate it to be for this quarter and the coming quarter?
It's difficult to talk about on quarterly basis, right?
Mm-hmm.
But again, the more important point is, if you're looking at consumption, right,
mm-hmm.
as I said, on the macro side, if you look at the population and all, consumption is not going to be a difficult task.
Mm-hmm.
It's in terms of really if the cost of that really high goes up. For example, you know, if you're buying something, say you're buying a mobile phone for 40,000 rupees, how much EMI per month are you paying?
Right.
If the EMI goes up by 200-300 rupees, it's not going to bother you a lot.
Perfect.
Till then, we are fine.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, but if really costs go up and rates really go up, you could see growth maybe coming down slightly. But will it come down? Today, if you look at it, system-wide credit growth is about 15%. NBFCs, yes, you know, they're doing good because of some of the banks who are under PCA, they cannot lend. So, you know, so we feel that growth is higher. But when you multiply and add all these growth up for the entire system, it's still 14-15%. Mm-hmm. It's not 25-30% for the entire system. Yes, for a particular set of market, it's high because they are taking advantage of the market share gains.
Right.
So I thought that overall system growth of 14-15%, I don't see it coming down to 10-11% in the next two quarters. You know, if I were to put it in my, you know, and as many words,
okay,
I don't see a big fall in that 14-15% overall system credit growth.
Okay. Okay. So basically, you are saying there can be a marginal slippage, but
marginal,
not a.
There could be a marginal slippage, but again, if we're talking about next two quarters, it's very difficult to predict. But we have
right.
next quarter is a Diwali season.
Absolutely.
It's the festive quarters.
Right.
So if you want to feel the pinch, you know, you may not feel it in the next two quarters also.
Which is.
You have to keep that also in mind.
And then possibly you enter an election year.
Yeah.
Next year.
So, yeah.
Okay, so interesting. Yeah, I think that's an interesting take. For all those who have joined us late, this is a live interaction with Mr. Rohit Singhania from DSP Fund House. We are just discussing about markets and discussing Rohit's take on what he feels about the economy. Rohit, so we broadly, let's say if the time horizon is long and people are, if fundamentally they are buying the right quality, then there's nothing to worry. We get all that. But today, let's say a retail investor who is a mutual fund client, basically, who is wanting to invest his hard-earned money through SIP or through small chunks of lump sum amounts, what should his approach be? And if you can bifurcate that in terms of what should be a retail investor's outlook be, how should he go about doing his
right.
investments, and what kind of strategies
do you
have?
It's very important for any investor to understand, timing the market, it is just next to impossible. So today when we as fund managers, investors buy a stock, are we sure it's not going to fall down tomorrow?
Mm-hmm.
Or if we sell a stock, are we sure the price is not going to go up higher tomorrow, right?
Right.
So at that point of time, what we feel actual right is, we should take that.
Mm-hmm.
So as an investor, don't try to say ki, today market is up 2% or market is down 2%, let me withdraw or put money. You're putting money into equities, you're putting not money for the next 3 months, 6 months, 9 months. You at least have 2 year time horizon. You know how our economy is, you know what kind of deficiencies we have, what we need. So I said, rather than timing the market, have the time frame. I want to invest for next 2 years, 3 years. Lump sum SIP, it's always been a debatable, you know. So
mm-hmm.
yes, SIP has proven much better because it gives you a chance to average out also, and it gives
right.
you a feeling you have not lost out also. So there's nothing bad to it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, for investors who really, you know, who like investing lump sum and all, I mean, you can. Putting everything one day is still not advisable. I mean, you can put it over the next 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. Because again, you know, timing for a retail investor, I think he or she or the institution, they're busy with their own work.
Mm-hmm.
They have their own businesses or services. I mean, I don't expect them to look at markets every day and then take a call. And that's
mm-hmm.
where you guys come in, right?
Perfect.
So idea is, if they understand the value mm-hmm. of time, you know, putting time into the stock or putting time into the market, I think that's more important than timing the stock or timing the market, I would say.
Perfect. So I think that's a legendary saying, that time in the market is more important than timing the market. We have a couple of questions out here from a live audience, and a few interesting ones. A tricky one too. What do you think is more vulnerable right now? Housing finance companies or NBFCs? And that's
think,
a question
think,
we got.
So I think SEBI and compliance doesn't allow me to answer these questions. But as I said, you know, you mentioned NBFCs, housing finance companies,
right.
there are baskets.
Okay.
You know, so as a fund manager, I have to avoid the bad ones.
Mm-hmm.
So I cannot say as a basket they're bad or a basket they're good.
Okay, so can you highlight possibly, let's say, DSP's outlook on or sectoral calls currently?
So right now, if you see, you know, we are overweight financials,
okay.
we are overweight pharma,
mm-hmm.
we are slightly underweight on IT. On the consumer discretionary side, we are neutral. On industrials and infra, we are overweight. Oil and gas, we are underweight. So
okay.
that's the broad. But again, viewers, now again, the whole thing, I give you the sector, you know, where you
yeah.
are. But what constitutes inside it, that's why I give, for example, my funds, right? You mentioned
Perfect.
The three funds I track.
Right.
So I'm overweight on financials. But on corporate finance, I'm higher overweight.
Okay.
So right? on the retail,
okay.
I'm lower. So if you ask
Understood.
Me, yes, financials, I'm overweight, yes.
Mm-hmm.
But what part of financials? That's more important to understand.
Okay, and I think out here we are breaking even deeper between housing finance.
Yeah,
and
I mean,
yeah.
I would like to avoid that.
Okay,
yeah.
so no,
yeah.
no, we understand
yeah.
your compulsions out here, but
yeah.
Interesting side of questions. Volatile markets, again, I think it's more a question which, do arbitrage funds make sense, or person should continue to be in whatever liquid or
See,
equity kind of?
Arbitrage, I would say, is totally different category.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a person who wants to invest in fixed deposit plus rates. For them, it's an arbitrage fund.
Right.
Markets going up, markets going down, they are that kind of investor they're supposed to be there, mm-hmm. right? Liquid, again, I would say for today, if you're a market, you know, equity investor and you still have this balanced fund category, right, where you have at least 25% invested in fixed income. But if you're a long-term investor, you know, then it comes is, you know, it's again the question to you, what kind of age profile, what kind of earnings profile the, you know, the investor is.
Perfect.
And then, you know, for me to talk, I'm going to give a general answer. For me, I would say you should always be invested in equities.
Mm-hmm.
But again, that's coming to you, you know, in terms of age profile, you know, when the person is going to retire.
Right.
So when you want to shift to equities, to do it at what point of time?
I think, yeah.
So I would say if you're earning till 50, 55, you know, I would say for my money, it's all 100% into equities, you know, whatever.
Got you.
So that's how you should divide it.
Perfect. So I think Rohit has a valid point out there. And this is more a question for us to tackle in terms of the advisory allocation for a client. And it will all depend on your risk profile, how much equity and how much debt do you want to hold in your portfolio. And there are merits of holding a hybrid or an arbitrage kind of a category in a portfolio always. And I think individually we can, depending on a client's profile, we can assess that and possibly advise on the course of it. And we can take that in much detail individually, basically. We have a couple of stock specific questions, which possibly I would like to avoid. I think more to do with the market scenario, which has been playing out of late. And there are a few names which are propping up in the market. It's just about whether as a philosophy is market avoiding those names now completely because of quality issues or what happens, let's say. Okay, so I will make it a bit generic. If there is a name in question which is going out in the market, what is the approach which fund managers typically adopt? Do they avoid that name completely, or there can be a bargain value in those names which are floating around?
See, I think floating around is a very wide word, right?
Yeah.
It's like one is fiction and one is facts.
Right.
So when we hear from something for the first time,
mm-hmm.
you always should take it as fiction.
Okay.
Because you never know the facts,
mm-hmm.
right? So idea is, you've heard this, find out the facts, try to find out the facts.
Perfect.
Try to do things, you know, do your work. That's where, you know, expertise lies. Then if you think you're not able to find out or you're not sure, I mean, just stay away. Or if you're able to find out, you may just stay, you know, just take a call. Just don't hear something and say, okay, ye kharab hai, ye acha hai. I may tell anything to you today, you know, this is, I may have a position, I may do whatever with it.
Right.
The idea is, don't go by hearsay, try to dig into, you know, like, culprit always uses the word evidence. Is there evidence to what someone is saying? If you don't have the evidence, you can't prove it right or wrong, right?
Interesting.
So I'll put it that way.
Cool. Let's change the track a bit towards the coming year, basically, right? So very soon we'll enter an election phase in the market. Right. And so how do you think next year should, ideally, I know it's a short term view again, how do you think being an election year, it pans out for economy per se and for markets in general?
See, if you go back last 6-7 general elections, right,
mm-hmm.
and if we were just reading some notes 1 year, you know, 6 months prior to every elections, so you always have this fear. What if, you know, it's election period, what happens, mm-hmm. what if there's a change in government, what happens? But if you look at it today, where we stand, you know, in terms of policies, in terms of things, I don't think it is easy for anyone to reverse that.
Okay.
So if something has started right, it will continue. Right? That's the first part, at least for you and me, what we need to understand.
Perfect.
Two, it is all these news flows, what we are hearing about US trade tariffs, trade wars. I think over the next 2 or 3 months, we'll surely have some clarity on it.
I'm sure.
In terms of really what's happened.
Yes.
Third is, when you look at the corporate earnings growth. So what's changed it, you know, if we had done the same thing last year, say in October, November,
mm-hmm.
we would talk about great macros and maybe corporate earnings so picking up.
Right.
Today we're talking about surety of or some more confidence in corporate earnings.
Mm-hmm.
And macros not great, but not bad also. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the change, you know.
Right.
So if that corporate earnings continue to be it is, then the GST, what we are all talking about today, we hear in newspapers, you know, shortfall of X thousand crores a month eventually. Eventually, as more and more it gets dug into the system,
mm-hmm.
I think from next year, I think would be the, you can assume in the first year, maybe, you know, GST is full-fledged and implemented.
Absolutely.
And the way it would. So you would have better tax collections also over there.
Right.
So I think looking at those aspects, I think even if you're taking the next 1 year, 1.5 year view, and if I look at the FY20 numbers in terms of expectations of earnings growth,
mm-hmm.
I think it's a good time to be in equity markets.
Okay.
But yeah, be rest assured, be ready for volatility.
Mm-hmm.
Because all the equity investors in calendar 2017 have forgotten the stocks can fall also.
Absolutely.
Keep that in mind.
Right. No, there is true. There is no two doubts, and I think people are going through that scenario where they're seeing some correction in their invested values and
right.
so on and so forth. Right. And I think what Rohit is mentioning on a broader basis is that believe in the philosophy, believe in the right stock picking ability. Right fund managers is an extremely critical component of that entire thing. Fund managers with the longest track record, Rohit being one of them, being in the industry for such a long phase. And having managed 3 or 4 funds consistently over a long duration, that just helps to build the overall credibility that stock picking is not just a one-off exercise, but a bottoms-up approach. And one more important point which came out from the conversation is that it's not always about the right sector or wrong sector. It's always what pockets in that particular sector
like what we say, you know, what you own. So it's very important what you avoid also, right? It may be in the same sector or whatever.
Absolutely.
That's you have to keep in mind.
We have one more question, and if we can take that. Once the dust settles on the currency and credit, and that's the question actually, will the growth become based on those few stocks getting flows currently? Will the premiums come off? As in, will the market chip off some premium to Indian markets is what possibly the question
see,
is.
So if you look at the multiples of Indian markets and you compare it to other emerging markets,
mm-hmm.
yes, we are on the higher side.
Right.
But because there's a reason for it, we have better growth,
mm-hmm.
a higher growth and more confidence on the growth. Right. So that's one reason. If you just look at, again, you just look at the number, yes, it is like, you know, expensive.
Right.
It's like talking about large cap versus mid cap. Today, when I look at large cap valuations and mid cap valuations,
mm-hmm.
yes, I would definitely tell you mid caps are very, very expensive today also.
Okay.
But am I ready to buy a mid cap today? Yes. If I find a good name, you know, I see that it fits into my investment parameter, I'll buy it.
Mm-hmm.
I will not shy away saying, you know, it's a mid cap, how can I buy a mid cap?
Right.
So, yes, we are at a slightly on a higher side of valuations when we compare ourselves historically
mm-hmm.
and, you know, global emerging markets. But the growth, what I'm talking to you about, the corporate earnings growth,
right.
if they come back, and mind you, the fiscal, except for current account deficit, I mean, it's there in place. So I think balance sheet and multiples can continue to prevail, you know, or be higher.
Okay.
It has to be a global reset, fine.
Mm-hmm.
But then, yeah, I think the premium could continue for a longer period of time.
Even if US were to bounce back as the growth engine of the world, which it does.
Yeah, so far, then I would say if you look at India, right? Mm-hmm. India, we had a big export thing going on.
Right.
For the last 3 or 4 or 5 years, it's been, you know, gone down.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because Europe was not doing that great. US was not doing that great.
Perfect.
China, you never knew whether it's hard landing or soft landing.
Absolutely.
So US starts picking up, Europe improves, then the export opportunity, which for the last 3-4 years for a lot of corporates was almost shut down
mm-hmm.
or halved. If that starts picking up, then you have another engine to growth.
Perfect. So interesting views out here for all those who have joined us for this interesting session on FB Live. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure having you, Rohit, in this live conversation, and we hope to hear from you very soon again. Just one last question before we part off. Is there any particular favorite of yours amongst the three which you manage? Opportunities, equity opportunities, tech saver, I'll keep it aside.
Okay.
TIG.ER and natural resources
See,
and
so
new energy fund.
If you kept tech, then it's easy for me, right?
Right.
The TIG.ER fund is a thematic fund
uh-huh.
which invests in companies related to infrastructure and economic reforms.
Right.
Natural resource fund is again a much closer thematic fund where I invest, I mean, the scheme manager to invest in commodities, materials and agriculture related companies. Equity opportunity fund is a large cap, mid cap fund, which is a diversified fund. So I always, you know, today if you're an investor and if you invest 100 rupees into mutual funds, I would still put my neck out and say out of the 100 rupees, 15 rupees should go in an infrastructure fund,
mm-hmm.
which is, I mean, in our case is a TIG.ER fund.
Right.
Natural resource, it's a lump sum kind of an investment. I would never put.
Okay.
I would never say, you know, do SIP. Because over there you can invest in just 2 or 3 sectors, right?
Perfect.
And taking an SIP approach is like when you feel a sector is right, you put in the money over there. You know, but there's no point doing SIP over there. So that's a trade call you have to take. So I would not say, you know, anytime you should be invested 10%, 15% or 5%. Bad opportunity fund, I would of course say, you know, if 15% is going into an infrastructure fund, then 80, 85 should come into a fund like opportunity.
So basically, the pecking order is you should ideally have
diversified fund. Why diversify? Right? Today, as a fund manager for diversified fund, I have an option or the ability to move across sectors.
Across sectors, yeah.
If I don't see a lot of companies in one particular sector, I can move to other.
Perfect.
Whereas in a T.I.G.E.R fund, which is a thematic fund or a natural resource fund, I have limited exposure or movement allowed for me.
Perfect.
So how do I, you know, run that out?
Great. Thank you very much. We hope to hear from you when you think is the right time to take a lump sum plunge in the natural resources
surely,
fund. Right?
Surely.
Thank you so much, Rohit.
Thank
it was a pleasure having you here.
Thank you all. Good day. Thank you.
Thank you very much.